The 1500 Sturmgeschütz, which were manufactured by Krupps, used the Panzer IV tank chassis, combined with the highly successful L-48 gun. These machines were known as Sturmgeschütz IVs, but were no less successful than the old Stug III. The welded steel skirt were added to all Stug IIIs and IVs from 1943 onwards as a protection against the new hollow charge infantry weapons, which had wreaked so much damage since their introduction in late 1943.
Well, each tank had its own characteristics and for particular operational tasks. And you can see in the German evolution of German Sturmgeschütze, you know, the German assault guns, some had very long wartime lives, which was astonishing. They proved to be sturdy, they proved to be reliable, and they proved to do their job quite well. And they were to the satisfaction both of their crews, and they fitted well into the tactical scene.
By the end of the war, no less than 30,000 enemy tanks had been destroyed by the Geschütz crews, a ratio of approximately 3 enemy vehicles to every Stug deployed. It was a mark of the achievement of the guns and the crews that Russian orders forbade their tank commanders from entering into artillery duels with the Geschütz, ordering them instead to maneuver to find the weaker side and rear armour. One famous variant of the Stug IV was a real heavyweight, the forerunner of the Sturm Tiger. This was the mighty Brumbar, the grizzly bear, or grumbler, which carried a powerful 15-centimeter howitzer. The Brumbar had sloping frontal armor, 100 millimeters thick, and it was designed to rumble up to infantry fortifications before firing its massive shell at point-blank range. The Brumbar was originally developed to cope with the close-quarter street fighting at Stalingrad, but delays in production meant that they did not see active service until the Battle of Kursk in 1943. After Kursk, Germany was largely fighting a defensive war, but on the few occasions when the Brumbar saw action, they acquitted themselves well, and over 300 were produced by the end of the war.
The Brumbar that you see behind me is nothing more than the chassis of the Panzerkampfwagen Mark IV with a big gun on it, mounted in the citadel, as you can see. And the reason this vehicle came about was the Germans learned very quickly in the Battle of Stalingrad that they had problems of taking out defensive positions in towns and also defense positions one and all. So this came about as to take out those type of positions. So you have a 150-millimeter gun, a very short little barrel gun, but it was very good for firing like plastic charges up against fortifications and knocking them out.
The eventual production of Sturmgeschütz totaled some 11,500, more than any other mark of German fighting vehicle. There were sound reasons for this, as not only was Sturmgeschütz successful on the battlefield, they were also far less expensive, quicker and easier to manufacture than fully turreted tanks built on the same chassis. This was a vital consideration for Germany's hard-pressed manufacturing industry. German armies on all fronts were desperate for armored fighting vehicles to stem the flood of Russian and Allied armor. So production resources were increasingly switched to the production of Sturmgeschütz, which were well suited to fighting a defensive war. In 1943, the role of Sturmgeschütz as protectors of the infantry was reversed, when each increasingly precious gun was given its own dedicated squad of grenadiers to protect these valuable machines against the increasingly sophisticated weapons carried by Allied tank hunting teams. Although it was not purpose-designed as a tank killer, the Stug had provided a solid solution to the tank destroyer role, almost by accident. German attempts to produce a dedicated tank killer by design were far more troubled. The Sturmgeschütz experience had shown that by dispensing with a tank turret, it was possible to mount a much heavier gun on the existing tank chassis. Despite the inevitability of the final defeat, the men of the Sturmgeschütz and Panzerjäger formations fought like lions to the bitter end. Losses grew to frightening proportions, and many panzer divisions fought until literally the last machine rumbled into its final battle. Even by the last day of fighting, the ranks of the Sturmgeschütz crews were still filled mainly with volunteers, who did their duty in the face of almost certain death. In later years, it was to become the proud boast that when the cry went up from the hard-pressed grenadiers, they were always there to answer their call to bring up the guns.